To build a house in an area of outstanding natural beauty like this outside Amersham is an impossible dream for most self-builders because of strict planning regulations. But this week's grand designers have managed to get permission for a new home in the Green Belt. I'm coming to meet Andrew Tate and Deborah Mills, who are going to build a family home which is part conversion and part new build. Andrew and Deborah's new build is designed to be invisible and to blend into the countryside. But the other half of their project sticks out very, very visibly.
We'll just come down.
Good Lord.
What an extraordinary place. How on earth did you find it?
We found it in a Sunday magazine article. There was another water tower that somebody had refurbished. And right at the end of the article, there were other water towers for sale, and there were two of them there.
You're joking.
One of them was this.
Not exactly a premeditated decision then.
Not at all.
How high is it inside?
Inside, it's 84 feet to the tank, and the total building is exactly 100 feet high.
Of course, it looks higher than that because it's narrow, isn't it? The perspective is
yes.
Sort of shoots up.
Yes.
But even so, I wouldn't like to be 84 feet up on one of those wire ladders, would you?
To give you an idea, you can get seven stories of building in the main brick shaft before you get to the tank.
Deborah, to what extent do you think is this project mad? It's not the most practical of buildings.
No, in fact, I came to see it first. And I went home and I said, it's too tall, too narrow and too close to the road. And Andrew came to see it and he said, no, we're living there. And I suppose I just got sort
but
of
what did you
sucked
say
along with his enthusiasm.
Were you converted?
I've never been very conventional, so the idea of living somewhere really strange appeals to me.
What on earth makes you think you can live in a place like this?
Well, what we're doing is building a new building as well next to it. So we really couldn't live in this building by itself because there's only a single floor per story.
Yeah.
But with the new building that we've designed, we can really create a fantastic family home here.
And you're the architect of the project?
Yes.
So that's...
Well, we both are really, but I am.
Yes.
I'm the client.
Right.
You're the architect. Andrew would spend $3 million on this, if he could.
The water tower was built in 1916 by German prisoners of war. Water was pumped from the reservoirs that lie beneath the grassy banks next to it, up to the metal tank on top, which gave it enough pressure to feed the Amersham area with mains water. The water tower fell into disuse in 1990 when modern pumps were installed. The tower will be converted into a bedroom wing. The new building will have a grass roof and grassy banks on the side, mimicking the reservoirs next door and making it invisible from the road. The entrance to the tower will lead into a radically different space, uncompromisingly modern, open plan, with glass walls either end, and three small rooms off the side. And there'll be a sheltered Mediterranean-style courtyard outside. The site cost £55,000, and Andrew and Deborah are planning to spend a further £350,000, which they've raised from a mortgage. Buildings like the tower pose a bit of a problem. They often stand in beautiful countryside, but they've also often become landmarks. Local people don't want them knocked down. Andrew and Deborah's solution was to propose an extension that looks like the reservoir banks on the outside, but they had to convince the planners.
Obviously, being in Greenbelt to start with, they said absolutely no extensions to the tower. And we said, well, this really isn't going to be acceptable because living one room above another all the time, what happens if your kitchen's the third floor up? Do you lug all the groceries up to that level? And what happens if the doorbell goes when you're on the fifth floor? So we started to form a story together of why we needed to have a new building. And we presented to the local parish council.
It was on a cold February night and Andrew started presenting and there was a power cut. All the lights went out, street lights, village hall lights, everything, totally black as it gets in the country. I went out, fortunately I'd parked right in front of the window, so I put my headlights on. But everybody else got little torches out of their pockets.
They'd all walked across the fields.
They walked across the fields and stuff. And so Andrew sort of did the rest of his presentation and there's a wonderful sort of torchlight, which was
extraordinary.
So we actually wonder in the end whether they like what we did or we just got a vote of sympathy for presenting in a
Does it matter?
No.
So they all liked that?
They unanimously supported our application and I think without that we didn't have very much chance at all of getting our planning through.
The local villagers may have lent their support, but the local planning officers were opposed. They let the application go through to the final committee stage, but they recommended that it should be refused. Andrew and Deborah set about lobbying as many councillors on the planning committee as they could. Now, this is something that you're perfectly entitled to do, sending in as much visual material, like drawings and photographs, as you think appropriate. Andrew even went as far as ringing some of the councillors up. Now, in this case, the key factor was the fact that there was already a building on the site, and a building that had become a local landmark at that. So the councillors were faced with a dilemma, whether to allow a new building to go up in the green belt, or whether to allow an old one to rot. The permission went through by 9-8. It's taken 3.5 years in planning and preparation to get started. It shows that if you want something badly enough, you have to fight to get it. But the build itself is going to take a mere 5 months. It's a wintry day in November when the foundations start to go in. And despite the weather, the groundworks will be ready by January. At last, the family can look forward to leaving their present home in Watford. Deborah bought this house when she was single, and after his previous relationship ended, Andrew moved in with her 8 years ago. They've now got 3 children, aged 4, 3, and 1.5.
This really was never designed to be our family house. This was just for me and my mates to live in and party. And it sort of evolved into a family house when we had our 3 children. And Andrew's never really felt it as home, I don't think.
Deborah used to work as a thermodynamic engineer. She's running the finances for the build and chasing up suppliers, as well as being a full-time mother.
Fabulous. Thanks very much. Bye-bye.
Who's that, Mummy?
That was the man for the sewage treatment plant.
Andrew is a partner in an architectural design practice with offices in central London.
I like the idea of this road coming in off the roundabout. Perhaps we should talk to...
Andrew's heading the design team on a £37 million refurbishment for the British Museum, which includes making a 260-room hotel.
The commercial view that I have had a big effect upon the design for the new building part of the tower. We're using commercial techniques, certainly the structure and the glass walling, the curtain walling, is something that we would use for a commercial building.
The first principle of Andrew's commercial approach is speed. They call it fast-track building. He's chosen a floor made of concrete beams 6 metres long. The concrete beams sit on cast plinth walls. They fit exactly. The beams are pre-cast with ridges for breeze blocks to complete the floor. The whole process takes 1 day, including minor adjustments. It's still Wednesday. Down the road, the steel that'll provide the framework is being finished. Steel and concrete may not be all that environmentally friendly in their production, but they're key materials for fast-track building. Thursday, we're ready for the walls to go up. Most of Britain's new houses are built out of these bricks and blocks. And to make a wall, you take a skin of bricks, maybe a skin of block or other brick, and you leave a gap in between to make a cavity into which you put insulation. Now, of course, Andrew and Deborah aren't being as conventional as that. This is grand designs. What they're doing is they're building their house out of this stuff, which may look like, well, leftover polystyrene packaging, but in fact, this is a big brick. It goes together rather like Lego, and you build your entire wall out of this stuff, and then you pump concrete into the bits in between. And what you make by doing that is basically a concrete wall that has an insulating layer on either side. Now that makes the wall twice as insulative as a conventional wall. But there's another saving, and that is in time. To build a conventional wall out of brick, well, you probably need 10 days to put this house together, the two big walls we've got running parallel. But we think by using this system, we can put up those walls in just 2 days. The polystyrene shells are slotted together first. They're all in place by the end of the day. Friday, the steel frame arrives. This is the structural frame to support the roof. Vertical columns are set into the ground and a hole is drilled into the tower wall. It's 3 feet thick at the base and very hard. Then one side of the structure is bolted together. We're used to seeing these frameworks on big commercial projects, but not domestic buildings. It's Saturday. The concrete arrives for the Beko walls. This technology was introduced on Tomorrow's World in 1979, but it didn't catch on in the building industry, which is naturally conservative. In those days, people weren't as concerned with conserving energy and heating as they are today. This material was Deborah's choice. To date, there are only around 200 houses in Britain built using this system.
We'd normally say an experienced building team could go onto site in the morning and start at ground floor level and have the walls up to eaves level for a bungalow block built and concreted by the time they go home in the evening. In terms of the actual build costs, we normally would say probably about £29 a square metre for the wall form components and £5 or £6 a square metre for the concrete. That's a lot more than bricks and blocks would cost, but the labour is a fraction of that. So at the end of the day, we get a balance on the overall cost.
So, in 4 days, there's a floor, a steel frame, and walls. A whole week later, an age in this build, and the roof's arriving.
One of the interesting things about building a house is how the size of it apparently changes as the build develops. You mark it out on the ground, it seems vast, and then you put the floor in, suddenly the whole thing seems to shrink. Put the walls up and it seems large again, rather like a sort of open air garden with this big sky above it. And yet when you put the roof on again, suddenly, well, it shrinks a bit. But it's at that point that you can see whether you've made a mistake or not, whether the interior space works. And that's something we're going to be able to tell in about 2 hours.
The last steel beams are put into place. They're connected to the frame at one end, but the other end just sits on the wall. That's less than a foot thick. It all seems so, so simple.
Everything's under control, so I therefore assume that you're on budget and on target for your schedule, yes?
Yes.
Yes, we are.
You're going to put that in writing?
Yes, we are.
You're happy? Great, that's marvelous. Yeah, that's wonderful to hear.
Yeah, yeah. I think instead of being completely stressed out by the total experience, we're actually very excited. And we love coming here. I mean, I dropped my eldest daughter off at the school, and I always stop, every time I go past, I stop, put my wellies on, come and have a look, see what's going on. It's so interesting, so exciting. It's brilliant.
I mean, day to day, how many people have you got? Who's organising the thing?
We have a site manager on site all the time, provided by the construction company. And that is just fabulous. In fact, when we were looking through the costs and sort of trying to cut costs, we looked at the cost of the site manager and thought, oh, perhaps that's something we could cut out. Andrew specifically said, no, we can't.
The roof comes in the form of 11-metre-long concrete slabs, each weighing 6 tonnes. They're breathtakingly large. It's the sort of thing you associate with motorway bridge construction.
It's brilliant!
It really is. It's real big stuff, isn't it?
I know. And look, they're taking them right up over the tree. You should probably be able to see it for miles around. It's wonderful.
It's remarkable how it kind of gives you an instant dwelling, isn't it?
An instant space. And also, underfoot, it's so tight. It's just, it's just... Everything's been manufactured to within such great tolerances. It's excellent. You sort of think, are they going to fit? How do they know they're going to fit? And of course they do. It's wonderful.
Bit like building a car park.
Bit like building a car park, but it's my house. It's going to be my house. It's going to be wonderful.
So they're all in position.
Yeah.
My goodness. Oh, it's very, very different, isn't it?
Gives it a completely different feeling of space, doesn't it?
Yeah.
It's
now, is it as you imagined it to be?
I think it pretty much is now. The roof's on it really is the sort of scale that I'd imagine it.
It's tall. What
in my mind, it feels bigger than when the roof was off. Do you get the sense of it just being a larger, sort of wider volume?
Space.
So, walking here, we've got, this is, that was utility. This is bathroom.
Yes.
This
with
is
the
bathroom.
Skylight.
With the skylight above.
Yeah.
And this is playroom.
That's right.
Right. And they all open onto.
They all have a door that opens onto the main space.
Right.
So all individual doors.
And this is all glass. And outside is the garden.
This is the special winter garden for the children. This is our room outside.
And then this is the link corridor.
Well, through
up into the tower, and we go up to where the yellow mark is, the lowest yellow mark on the wall,
yes.
Which is the floor of the tower. So there will be 4 or 5 gentle steps up there from the main space.
So as people arrive, they walk into the tower. I mean, all they see when they arrive is the tower.
Yes, which is actually quite a protected space. You've got these really thick walls, quite a dark space,
like a
cozy sort of space.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
So it'll be nice to come out of the tower and walk down into this space.
For all this to go up in 2 weeks, it needs meticulous planning. Andrew's detailed everything on this build in a 300-page document, but it's the project manager who has to put it into action.
This must be a very different kind of build for you, isn't it? I mean, beco walls and concrete lintels and that kind of stuff?
Yeah, it's totally different from the traditional.
So how have you coped with that? I mean, has that presented its own problems for you?
Not at all, no. It's been very easy to build. Very straightforward, yeah.
Yeah. I mean, what do you put that down to? Is that luck or is that...
I think it's just basically different trades know what they're doing and we're getting on with it. We've got a vast amount of literature off of Andrew that we can refer it back to, so...
Doug's modesty belies his talents, but project management doesn't come cheap.
15% of your budget may be spent on architects, surveyors, engineers, but another 15% of your budget may be spent on having the project professionally managed. Now, that may sound like a lot, but in Andrew and Deborah's case, it means that they're going to get a house delivered in, half the time that it otherwise might take. Now, professional management is all very well when it comes to a new building, but Andrew and Deborah are going to be really challenged when it comes to this brute.
It's time to face the beast. It takes an age to climb these ladders, and it's freezing in here. There's mud stuck to every rung, and your fingers go numb. They've told me the trick is not to look down, but it doesn't seem to make any difference.
It has taken forever to come up this tower. Oh, God. It was a mistake to come up onto this bit here, because I can see terra firma below my feet through this grill, which isn't a very comforting view. And I'm just wondering how I negotiate getting back down onto that platform without falling off. I'm certainly not going up this ladder, I can tell you. Oh God. Crawling, it's the best way. Oh, that's a little better. But the views are wonderful. And I would like to say it was worth coming up here for that, but I'm not very good with heights. Not heights like this. Not heights where there are big holes that beckon you. The building looks great, though. I'm glad I'm not living here, though, I can tell you. So how often have you been out here?
This is the third time I've been to the top.
And outside?
Outside once.
All the way around?
No.
On the ring?
No.
Looking through your feet?
I can't manage that yet. I am getting better and better each time I come up. The what? First time I came was on my own, and I got halfway up the tower. And scared myself something stupid and went down again. But then coming up with other people, you sort of... Yeah. Bite your tongue, I suppose, and go for it. But the views are worth it if you can keep your nerve.
Why did you buy it if you can't cope with the heights?
I think it's not so much the heights as the ladders. I managed to convince myself that once the stairs are in there and it's a nice, comfortable walk up, then I'll be okay.
You'll be okay, like being in a block of flats,
that's
I guess.
Right,
similar kind of thing, except as long as you're not having to come out here.
That's right.
What about the kids? I mean, it's not exactly going to be the most child-friendly structure, is it?
They will not be allowed anywhere near here.
But supposing they just decide they're going to?
They won't be steps up here.
You're actually just not going to make it physically possible to
get up. That's right, it won't be physically possible for them to get up. It has to be that way. It's just too dangerous anyway.
Good, good. Well, that means I won't have to come up again either.
No. You don't have a problem, do you, Andrew?
No, I've been up here so many times now.
How many times?
Oh, I come up here twice every time I'm here, so I should think it must be in the hundreds of times I've been here.
Oh, my goodness. You just swing around like a monkey.
If you look down between the gap in the trees, on a clear day, you can see all the towers of central London. And I can see Canary Wharf Tower, which is about 28 miles away.
How incredible.
Then further, I can see Crystal Palace Aerial as well, and then the North Downs in Hampshire. So I've actually, on a map, joined all the furthest dots that I can see together, and I make an area of about 1,000 square miles.
What about these cracks in the wall, though? I mean, are they a problem?
No, I think the fact that the building has been here for so long, they're okay. The brick shaft is actually broken into three complete pieces.
Which are held together, by my reckoning, by this by this walkway that you're standing on.
It has taken 50,000 gallons of water before, and now there's no water in there at all, so there's nothing like the load it used to have. It's stood all this time, and I think it will stand without much repair from us, other than decorative, for many years to come.
I'll take Andrew's word for it that the tower isn't going to fall down. So far, everything he's told me would happen has happened, on schedule and on budget. And some of the design elements aren't simple. Two walls in the new building are solid, but the other two will be made of glass panels in timber frames.
It's called curtain walling because the entire wall of glass is hung. It's a look I associate with modern hotel lobbies and shopping centres. Andrew's background in commercial design is showing, and elsewhere, commercial techniques are being used even for the smallest details.
This is instead of ordinary timber stud work, isn't
That's
it?
Right,
this is metal stud work.
Yeah.
The kind of stuff they use in offices.
That's correct, yeah.
But I mean, does it go up much quicker than timber?
Oh, you fly up in no time, yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
But you're using conventional plasterboard?
Yeah, just ordinary board.
Just screw it straight up?
Just screw it straight onto the metal.
Where are the holes then?
You just self-tapping screws straight through the board. Yeah. And into the metal.
Is that magnetic?
Yep.
See, that just clips on there and you just. That's and it goes straight into the metal. Don't show me, I don't believe. That must make it really quick. That's it. Oh, goodness me. Yeah, and you get your bit falling down, don't you? Incredible.
It's all very impressive, but I'm becoming a little apprehensive about the new building. The roof slabs are just sitting on one of those thin walls, and my understanding is that tons of earth are going to be put up against it to form the grassy bank that'll make the house invisible from the road. Deborah, an engineer herself, has brought the structural engineer for the project along to answer some of my questions.
Ever since I saw this house go up, I've looked at that Beko wall, which is basically polystyrene blocks filled with concrete, and wondered how on earth it supports what it does. This end is great. You've got at this end, you've got this great steel structure, and that's quite a strong wall there, isn't it? But this wall, you have the Beko, which is represented here by an ice cream wafer, which I think is a fairly representative model. And then you've got these great, great heavy concrete lintels, haven't you, which are the roof lintels. Roof, what do you call them? Beams.
They're actual slabs over there.
Slabs, yes. Yeah. Now, the problem, I think, comes is when you're building this huge bund next to it.
Yep.
Yeah? There's the, this is the earth, right?
Yeah.
Which is the earth up here. And what I'm suggesting is that the weight of all that earth, I mean, the lateral pressure, surely, isn't that going to just do sort of that?
That's not quite the right example. This is a self-supporting structure, the actual bund itself. So it wouldn't have any lateral pressure imposed onto the wall.
Right.
And also, it's not having the earth banked up against it. It's having polystyrene cubes. There's no force in this direction.
There's no lateral force. But when I looked at those great big concrete beams going down onto that little thin wall, there's no steelwork in there, is there?
You were
scared,
weren't you?
I was scared. I love the building. Don't get me wrong. I think the building is a fantastic design. It's a beautiful, beautiful, spacious design. But the idea of sitting underneath 90 tons of concrete supported on that very thin polystyrene wall.
It's wrong to call it just a polystyrene wall. Let's get things correct, really. It's not that dramatic, is it? It's a concrete wall.
Yeah, but the concrete's this thick.
It's about 6 inches thick, yeah. And the actual polystyrene is used as a mould.
You wouldn't put steelwork in there.
The forces are all in compression there. They're all actual loads down.
And down.
It doesn't actually need steel.
Can we prove that?
Well, let's try with something a bit more weighty, shall we?
What? That's rather weighty.
So nobody would think the wafer would hold, would they? But the wafer is in compression.
But we're talking about concrete, not the wafer.
Engineering class. So we're talking, yes, exactly. So that's a concrete-filled wafer.
Mm.
So that's right.
Really, yeah. Really, really rather strong.
Yeah.
Thank you. You've answered that question.
Pleasure.
This is the underfloor heating that's going in, and it is such an elegant system. This is just a huge piece of 8x4 polystyrene that just gets laid flat on the top. It's got this foil over it. It's got these grooves into which they're laying all this piping to carry the hot water that's going to heat the floor. And on top of this, there's going to be a floating timber floor, as I understand it. So that whole thing is going to go down really quickly. And it's going to heat the house exactly the way you want it, you know, underfloor beneath your feet so you can walk around in it barefoot. It'll be wonderfully comfortable. It sort of epitomises the whole build. And the whole thing has gone very quickly, very elegantly. Minimum of fuss, minimum of problem. It makes you wonder why all buildings aren't constructed like that.
Outside, there's another elegant solution.
The courtyard garden will be protected from the noise of the road by a stone wall with grassy embankment facing out onto the road. The wall will be made from gabions, wire cages filled with rubble. And to make them look good, the side facing into the courtyard has a surface of Welsh pebbles. The backs, facing the road, will be banked with earth. These gabion walls are yet another unconventional material. They're normally seen forming the walls of motorway cuttings. This time, Andrew's building them himself, with a little help.
I'm enjoying helping out at the moment. Normally I do spend all of the time in the office, and I must admit the fresh air is getting the better of me, certainly did last night. But what I want to do is set a standard of quality here for the front gabions into the courtyard. And it's a little bit suck it and see at the moment how we're developing them. So they need to be clamped and crimped and wired back because the gabions actually bulge, and we need to make sure that they're set out correctly and they look, they, you know, they all go together properly.
You're fine.
Oh, yeah. Don't do that. Spend all the time.
I have to confess that I have a real liking for this building. Real liking. It's not excessive. It simply provides them with all the room they'll ever need as a family, what with the water tower as well. But it's not a huge, overblown statement.
But with an architect for whom design is all, and a client thinking of family comforts, choosing the furniture might not be so easy.
At this stage in a build, most people are still struggling with decisions such as where are all the sockets going or which tiles to put in the bathroom. But true to form, Andrew and Deborah are way ahead of the game. They're choosing new furniture to go with their new design. Not that I think this is a luxury, mind you. I think that if you're going to all the trouble of building a new space, then it's rather a shame to fill it with all the old stuff from your old house. So why not leave a little in the budget for shopping?
I think it would go really well with the timber on the floor. It's very nice.
I don't think it's big enough, that size.
Oh. Yes, no?
No.
No, I don't think so.
I'd go for the black leather as well.
Would you?
Yes, to make the whole frame stand out.
No.
So, Andrew, is this executive enough for you?
I think they're nice, actually. They're grand and they're really quite comfortable.
But they're really territorial. They're sort of, this is my space. I'm very masculine.
The arguments are great. I love them.
They're great if you're in the dentist.
Yeah, I suppose they're so architectural. They're pieces of sculpture in a way in their own right. Yeah, I love them for that.
Yeah.
I don't like them.
Do you think that's because of the black leather you don't like, though? I mean, I think the frames are wonderful.
They're beautifully really designed chairs, but I don't want them in my house. I want a sofa that looks like you can just sort of sink into it and
a recognisable
take your
shoes sofa.
Off. Yeah, right. Just sort of relax. One that looks like it's comfortable and that you can just sit in and forget about what you've done.
This is really comfortable. I'm not sure about the colour, though.
No, I don't like the colour, but I do like the fabric.
Being choosy,
it's quite soft.
And it's loose covers, so it's easy to keep clean.
You can put a big tick by that, then.
Big tick.
Right.
Put a sticker on this one.
This build is running on a tight schedule. So tight that I think Andrew and Deborah are actually gambling on their efficiency. Their schedule allows them absolutely no room for error. For example, they have a fixed day to move in at the end of April, and that's the very day the contractors are due to leave site. That's just over a month away, and they haven't even started work on the tower yet. I'm beginning to wonder if this isn't asking things just to go a little too fast, even for this build. If I were to take an uncharitable view, I would say, new build, commercial architect, piece of cake. Historic building, great unknown. I mean, you haven't done anything to the tower yet, have you? I mean, is this because you've just sort of shied clear of it?
What we've been wanting to do is finish off the new building before we move on to the tower contract and just see how much money we've got left. I think with the new building is going to cost what it is within reason. And we don't want to skimp on the areas of finish, which is the areas that we're at now. I'd rather do a room less in the tower and then do that at some point in the future and get the new building right.
Personally, I'm sorry they're not going to convert the tower right away. It's such an intriguing building. But they've got to move out of their old house by the 30th of April because it's been sold. All energies need to go into getting the new build ready by then. Even without touching the tower, it's a race against time. We're less than 2 weeks from Andrew and Deborah's deadline for moving in, and trouble has struck from one of their technological innovations. The roof's leaking.
It's imperative that we find the leaks. We're not quite sure whether it's just in one location or in two or three. So it has slowed things up.
Are you still going to move in on the same day?
Yes, absolutely, yes.
It's not going to be affected by all of this?
No.
Because you're on such a tight schedule.
Yes, we are. I'm getting to the stage where I'm crossing my fingers and waking up early in the morning thinking I must do this and I must remember to tell somebody that.
Since Andrew's ordered a roof that doesn't leak, he can hand this problem over to the roofing contractors. They'll have to absorb the cost of making it watertight, not him. But Andrew's not a hands-off man on his build, and it doesn't look like I'll be much longer. They've asked me to bring my overalls today. Andrew's going to show me how to make this house invisible. Earth has been banked up against the back of the courtyard walls to form a slope facing the road that'll be covered in grass.
What we're going to do is put some terram down to start with.
What's terram?
Well, it's really to stop all the any of the topsoil going through into the clay.
Oh, right, yeah.
So,
well, that seems sensible.
If you put some of that down to start with, as a sample, what we've done is smoothed out the bank as much as we can.
Yeah, sort of flattened it down.
A bit clayey, unfortunately.
And then we're going to stick some topsoil on that.
And then, well, no, we'll actually put the, to start with, we'll put some of this soil erosion matting down, and then we put the topsoil into that.
Well, what are those? That looks like slats.
Yeah, what it's...
How does that work?
If you grab hold of that end, I'll show you. What we do is, if you...
So it's like
the bit
it's
at the
one
bottom,
thing.
Yeah.
It's one...
We just hold it.
It's a huge concertina.
Tremendous, isn't it?
It's fantastic. Oh dear, there's only one shovel.
An example so I can show you, really, before we really get going on it. And of course, what's below this bank are the gabions.
A bit more, please. It's very effective, though, isn't it? Because you can put the topsoil on in a very dry, crumbly form, which is good for levelling.
And if we didn't have that, the first time it rained, it would just run off the
absolutely,
bank completely.
Absolutely, yeah, I understand that. And then you just roll the turf out over that.
There we are.
It's great, isn't it? It's going to be really super. It's going to be a very enticing, meaty bank, isn't it?
Yeah.
Something for the children to roll down.
Yeah, yes, it will be.
And that one, 6 days to go. Andrew and Deborah are shelling out for an expensive finish. And thanks to Customs and Excise, they're saving 17.5% VAT, which isn't charged on new builds. But as soon as they touch the tower, the whole project becomes a conversion, and VAT is payable. And the moment they start, the tower hits them with its first surprise. They planned to cut out the doorway in 2 days. It took 2 weeks. Andrew and Deborah's house has taken 4 years in the planning, 10 months of intensive design and research, and just 4 months to build. And I can't wait to see it. But I do have a couple of questions. I still wonder whether Andrew hasn't designed an architect's indulgence for other architects to admire, or whether it's a livable space. And I still have this niggling doubt about open plan design. I mean, I know that it's a fashionable and desirable way to plan your space these days, and that it's synonymous with modernist architecture. But does it make for a good and practical home? Let's see. Very well.
Have a good trip up?
You've done a lot to this space then, since I saw it last?
Yeah, my mum said we've got the tallest porch in the world.
Exactly. Anyway, look, show me your house.
Okay.
Right.
I'm desperate to see it. It's extraordinary. Welcome to modern living. Look at it, isn't it? A wonderful space. It's so, so different. It's so kind of sleek and sharp and fresh.
I love the quality of light as well in here.
Yeah, it is.
Really,
incredibly
it's, that's what
light.
Really makes it, isn't it?
Incredibly light. It's all very beautiful, isn't it? I mean, beautiful is the word to describe this.
Thank you, yes.
It's also all very hard and crisp and very much Andrew's kind of, you know, that kind of design business, you know, commercial aesthetic, you know, which is very slick and very fashionable at the moment. Now, these, I just cannot believe, after that confrontational shopping trip, that these chairs are anything like what you want, are they?
The black leather and the chrome. No, but Andrew likes them. And I've got my squishy sofas. I mean, at the end of the evening, we'll sit down here, and I know Andrew will sit in one of these sofas, and he'll sprawl along them. He won't be sitting in his chairs. He'll be looking at his chairs.
He'll be looking at the chairs.
Fine. Sitting in the sofa.
They're defining space.
Yeah.
Yeah, they are.
Controlling the volume.
Yeah.
All
yeah,
that stuff.
Yeah, they are. Yeah.
And also with the sofas, what we need in such a big space is you need things to absorb the sound.
Yes,
so
that's
it's
true.
Really important to
and
have
the rugs
the rug
help,
and
they?
The big.
And that piece of furniture over there, stuck on its own. I mean, yes, that must be one that you've chosen, isn't it, Andrew?
Yes, isn't it fabulous?
I actually like it too.
Do you?
I do, yeah.
This is so, so much better than when I saw it last, you know?
Yes, it's come on that really, really quickly.
Great curving wall.
Yeah, this is the arm, the hugging arm.
Yeah. It's a dry, arid space in the middle.
It is, yeah,
shingle
it is.
And concrete.
You sort of wanted a semi-Mediterranean feel here, and it's nice to have that.
One of the reasons for building the bunk was to give you privacy and also to isolate you from the road outside, which is a busy A road. And I can still hear the traffic now.
Yes.
I think the wall has cut out quite a bit, but you can clearly hear the cars.
Until the tower's finished, the family are making do with temporary bedrooms. The small room facing the courtyard will eventually be the children's playroom. All three of them are sleeping here in the meantime. Next door, there's a small bathroom with Philippe Stark fittings. And Andrew and Deborah are bedding down in the room behind the kitchen with views out to the back garden.
It's our bedroom.
Oh, no, this is style. This is what I call gracious living in the late 20th century. This is really beautiful.
This is very temporary.
I think it is beautiful, actually. All the work on that wall, it's a real work of art, all of that, all the services there.
I have never seen such complicated pipework in a house. I suppose that's all the underfloor heating, is it?
Yeah.
Yes.
The manifold system for the underfloor heating. But, you know, who cares? I mean, it doesn't matter.
We're here now.
We only sleep in here, you know.
Yeah, you don't show guests this room.
No, absolutely
not. You just let
not.
Me see it.
The new build has cost £230,000. The site was £55,000, and they've set a budget for the tower of £120,000. Andrew's fees would be £35,000, so that gives a total cost of £440,000. The whole project has been valued at £450,000. The main open-plan space is designed to be flexible. To move the dining room, you just move the table. This explains Andrew's love of furniture with hard, clean lines that define areas. But good design is not just about how furniture and space look, it's about the way they work for people. I do wonder how Deborah and the children will use this space.
There's one thing I've been meaning to ask you. I've seen the inside of your house, your old house, and I know the way you've lived. And you, neither of you profess to be the tidiest of people.
When we build offices for people, we see them in dreadful, messy surroundings, and we design new offices around them. And they are much cleaner people. It does change the way that they work.
I'm beginning to think Andrew's built this beautiful house just so that I'll clean it. The stainless steel we're really pleased with.
Yeah.
A lot of people warned us it marks, it scratches. I don't care. We don't want a show home. We want a home that we can live comfortably in. And when the children are in bed and we have a dinner party, we can clear it up and make it look lovely.
Mm, yeah.
Mm. But it doesn't have to look like that the whole time.
Mm. I mean, is open plan this great 90s ideal? Is it a good idea? Where do you find your privacy here?
With young children, you don't get privacy. You go to the toilet, they come with you. Like, you know what I mean? It's sort of pointless trying to design that when you're not going to achieve it.
But all of us need some privacy from the noise of children's TV, from cooking smells, from prying ramblers, from each other. Even when the tower's converted, it'll still be a long climb to find any sanctuary. Perhaps having to make do with this one big living space will give them the drive to press on with the tower conversion.
Nothing like reading a quiet newspaper, is there?
Have you got the energy to go on?
I'd like a rest. I would like to devote some time exclusively to the children. I think that they've had a bit of a rough ride. And it would be quite nice to have some of the summer on our own, here, no builders, to enjoy it.
Really? The fact that the tower is there, and it's so inspiring in its own right, you know, I think I'll wake up tomorrow and I'll be desperately wanting to carry on with it.
I can't help suspecting that Deborah's a little reluctant to convert the tower at all, but maybe that's my interpretation, since I can't imagine any building less practical for living in. What happens when one of the kids leaves their homework in the top bedroom at 10 to 9 in the morning? I suppose if you live with an architect, you expect comfort and practicality to come second to pure design. Still, although a house that looks like a slice of airport terminal may not be to your taste, it is to theirs and to mine. And I've been totally bowled over by the speed and efficiency of this build.
On every other project in this series, I've had to lend a hand in some way or another, but apart from messing around with some turf and acting as mediator over Andrew and Deborah's differing taste in furniture, there's been very little for me to do here, because the build has gone so well. And I think I've learnt why. For any house to go up quickly and smoothly, I think you need three human cornerstones. You need an architect who is 100% on the case. You need a client, in this case Deborah, who is 100% on the case. And you need a project manager, someone like Doug, who is also 100% on the case. Now, take any one of these three cornerstones away, and I think the whole project lurches in the direction of disaster. And even if you've planned for the unexpected, something as epic as building your own house is always going to be a helter-skelter ride. It's never easy to turn your dreams into reality.